morning, church.
Good morning. Good morning.
Let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, as we look at your word this morning, we pray that you would give us worship. We pray that you would still our hearts, that we would be able to be focused on who you are, and that the distractions of the world would not be there. We pray this in your most blessed name. Amen. Can you hear me this morning? Is this on? Because I don't have a green light.
No.
So, I don't know what's going on with this thing today. I can just stay right here if that's okay. Alright. Well, last year, if you were watching TV, there was something that affected life. If you watched it, there was a show which depicted a crock pot having a short, and catching a house on fire. Anybody seen the show before? It's called This Is Us. And in the fire, one of the major characters actually passes away or loses his life. But the ramifications of that show was what was interesting. Crock pots, the stocks took a plunge just because of this show. And it tanked. Now, I have to say, I watched the show. I enjoyed it. A lot of people in my church were talking about it. So I started watching it. And it is a very good show. It's very well done. But a television show affecting that much of life was pretty amazing to me. A television show that hurt the stock market. It affected the world around it. Now, that is not the only television event that affects things. How many of you folks watch football? You know, how many have been to a Super Bowl party? It's a huge event. And one of the things that I have learned in ministry is don't plan anything if the Steelers are playing. Things can affect other things, like a game, a football game, really affects our culture, does it not? Another thing that has been interesting over the years with television is a television show finale. Now, I'm old enough to remember the finale of MASH, which kind of stopped America. Everybody stopped and watched MASH, the last episode of it. And shows like Seinfeld, they were even preparing they didn't plan things for that last episode. Now, maybe I am dating myself again here by saying this, but there was also a movie I worked in a movie theater when I was younger, and one of the movies that I worked during was a movie called E.T., The Extraterrestrial. And one of the things that they did with that movie was they promoted Reese's Pieces. Elliot had to lure the extraterrestrial back to his house with Reese's Pieces. And Reese's Pieces, because of this movie, became very popular. We all have things that have affected us or jazzes us. That movie jazzed us and we went out to get Reese's Pieces. And we have things that we're excited about. Like for me, when I was growing up, Christmas morning was really exciting in our house. It was hard to go to sleep because we were so excited. Or maybe you're going on a vacation or going to an amusement park. A friend of mine just posted a video of her daughter finding out that she was a Waldemere. They had driven up. They didn't know. She's about four. And they said, "We've gotten to your favorite place." And she's like, "Waldemere?" And she starts kicking and she's really excited. What if? We were that excited about worship. Have you ever thought about that? What if what we did in our worship really affected the world? What if I told you about something here this morning and it affected our culture, our world? It had a chain reaction and it started changing. Why is it that we get excited about things like Waldemere and then we drag ourselves to church? Why is that? Why is it that people don't go to a church service but they never miss a Steeler game? Why is it that a sappy television show that makes us cry can change the stock market, but the church has a really hard time making a dent in our world? Have you thought about that? Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that there is anything wrong with television, sports, or Christmas, or anything that I talked about. But I'm just wondering why there is so much more power, it seems, from those kind of things than something like worship. Because don't we have the best here? Don't we have the best story? Don't we have a Savior that saves us? Or maybe we just don't think about that. Maybe we don't think that way. No, we are talking about our mission statement in the next few weeks. Serve, worship, grow, serve, and go. That was our mission statement. When I first came here, it was proposed and council approved it. And today we're looking at the idea of worship. And the question is, why aren't we excited about it? Maybe you are. And if you are, then why aren't you bringing people with you? Why aren't we packing out this place on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and all throughout the week? Now, if I came this morning and did this, like, I am so excited about worship. I can't wait to be here. Couldn't wait to get out of that this morning. Or maybe the other way that I could come is just not being able to say anything because I'm so in awe. I wonder how many of you folks might be calling the DS and say, hey, could we have a refund on that pastor? Or maybe you might be calling a psychologist. Maybe it's just because we've lost what we are really worshiping. Take a look at this.
Says all things were made by Jesus and for Jesus. This means we were created to worship. There is only one who is really worthy of our worship. That's why nothing else in this world satisfies. We keep on looking, we keep on striving, we keep on buying, and nothing delivers. Nothing brings us that deep satisfaction that we long for. But when you live the life of Jesus as the center, you're doing exactly what you're created to do. You're right in the place you're supposed to be. So the irony is that when we give our lives over to worship Jesus, that's where we actually find ourselves. Everyone worships. But we were made to worship just one.
Everyone worships. Have you thought about it? I love that video. It really makes you think, does it not? It would be so interesting this morning to take some time to find out what each other worship. And most of us here probably would say we worship God, we worship Jesus because we're in church, right? But I wonder if we got our checkbooks out this morning and started looking at how we spend our money. How many of our checkbooks would show God or Christ? For we spend money on the things that we worship or the things that jazzes us. Before we go any further this morning, I think that we need to define what worship is. Wikipedia says that worship is an act of religious devotion, usually directed towards a deity. Dictionary.com defines it as reverent honor and homage paid to God or a sacred personage or to any object regarded as sacred. Webster Dictionary says it's giving honor or showing reverence to. So worship, then, is something that grabs our attention, something that gives honor to or reverence to it. And I think the real important thing here to look at is, what are we giving honor or reverence to? What is our God? Is it Almighty God? Is it Jesus? Is it the Holy Spirit? Or have you done something like what was mentioned in the video, made something else your God? Because we do that. And you know what? Sometimes we do it without even knowing that we're doing it. So we might need to check that out. The scripture that we're looking at this morning takes us back to the Old Testament, the book of 1 Chronicles. The people are worshiping over the Ark of the Covenant in this passage. And if you know anything about the Old Testament, or if you watched Raiders of the Lost Ark, you will know that what is in the Ark of the Covenant, it is the Ten Commandments, among others, some other items that are considered very reverent that are found there. The people at this time believed that the Ark of Covenant, was where God actually dwelt. It was where the presence of God was. That if you were in the presence of the Ten Commandments, you were in the very presence of God. It was God's symbolic home on earth. And here in this passage that we're looking at today is how they approached worship. Found in the 16th chapter of the book of 1 Chronicles, chapter 16, verses 23 through 31. If you're able to this morning, stand as we will read God's word. It's like this. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Proclaim his salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples. For great is the Lord, and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods. For the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and joy are in his dwelling place. Ascribe to the Lord, all you families of nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. The world is firmly established. It cannot be moved. Let the heavens rejoice. Let the earth be glad. Let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. So this is how they worshiped. This is how they worshiped in the presence of the Lord. They were singing. They were giving offering. They were praising God. They were claiming who God is. Splendor and majesty. Now there's a lot here in this passage this morning, and it could take weeks for us to really find out what was there. So hold on to that passage. Maybe take it with you. And think about, this is how we should be worshiping. It's a biblical example. If you look at it, it proclaims that this God that we are worshiping is not just for us. It is for all people. Not just within the walls of the church, or churches, but for all people. Stating that God is great not to only those within these walls of the church, but out there as well. We tend to think we own God as we come to church. God is for all the people. We tend to see someone who is struggling with addiction or maybe sexuality or unbelief as those are the people that need God. But truth be known, we need God just as much as they do, folks. What are you worshiping as of late? Have you thought about that? Is it God? Are you letting those around you know about the greatness of God? Are we in awe? Are we experiencing God to the fullest? If we are, we might be worshiping. Are we putting ourselves in the presence of God? For God is always present. But are we putting ourselves there with Him? As we think about this worship thing as part of our mission statement, this is the first question that we must answer. Who or what do we worship? This is not just a Sunday morning thing. Worship is a way of life. It's all the time. You know, Jesus came to tell us that God is with us always. So as you look at this passage this morning, living in the presence of God, are we living like what the passage says? Are we showing that it is God that we belong to? Are we throwing ourselves into God's holiness? Or is it just lip service? You know, when worship is going bad at a church, or when we feel worship is going nowhere, you know who we blame? Yep, that's right. It's the pastor's fault, right? But did you see in Scripture, anywhere in Scripture, as I read the passage, I did not see that it was necessarily the pastor's responsibility. It is our own responsibility to worship. For corporate worship, we must all be engaged. You know, I could come this morning with the best sermon ever. I could do some art. We could have the best music or a band or a choir here. But if we ourselves are not worshiping, it doesn't work. So this mission statement is going to call for a response. A mission statement is something that tells us what we're going to do, what we're aiming for. It's not static. It moves forward. It moves us forward. It is a plan. A plan is not a good plan if it is not lived out. But it cannot just be lived out. It will need prayer behind it too. I want to do this well and be faithful to who I worship. So I'm going to ask some people this morning, if you feel called to do this, to pray with me. One of the things that we have over on our card table is some sign-up sheets to pray for worship. We have two different opportunities that we're going to offer you this morning. We have one that is just a prayer team that would pray for worship in this church. And that might happen in a bunch of different kinds of ways. You might want to get together as a team and pray for this mission statement. You might want to get together and walk around the community and pray for that kind of thing. The other thing is we'd like to get some people to pray for the worship services here. You know, like, hey, if you're here at the 8 o'clock service, you may want to stay for the 9:30 service. Go somewhere in the church and pray for that service. We're asking some people to be able to do that for us so that while we are in worship, there are people praying for what is happening here. If you just need to do it home and pray for worship in this mission statement, that's fine too. But just let us know that you're committed to praying for our mission statement and worship. What if we became the church, the people that worships? Worship's the greatest story. The best to worship our living God. And that should be what changes us. And what changes the world. If television can do that, folks, what can we do? We should have sold-out seats every Sunday. We should be excited. And we should be ready to worship. Let's pray. Lord God, as we think about this opportunity to worship, we pray that you would move us, that you would grow us, that you would help us to examine exactly what we are worshiping. And Lord, if it is not you, we pray that you would confront us, that you would change us, and you would make us into the people who follow you. Lord, as we think about this mission statement, we pray that it will propel us forward and that we would be able to